وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد Inshallah ta'ala, today I'm going to start the explanation of the kitab Al-Shama'il al-Muhammadiyyah, written by Al-Imam Abu Isa Muhammad ibn Isa ibn Sawrat al-Tirmidhi, rahimahullahu ta'ala. We're going to take the first hadith in this episode, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem.
Qala al-Haafidh Abu Isa Muhammad ibn Isa ibn Sawrat al-Tirmidhi باب ما جاء في خلق رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الحديث الأول حدثنا أبو رجاء قتيبة بن سعيد قال عن مالك بن أنس عن ربيعة بن أبي عبد الرحمن عن أنس بن مالك أنه سمعه يقول كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ليس بالطويل البائن ولا بالقصير ولا بالأبيض الأمحق ولا بالآدم ولا بالجعد القطط ولا بالسبط بعثه الله تعالى على رأس 40 سنة فأقام بمكة 10 سنين فأقام بمكة 10 سنين وبالمدينة 10 سنين وتوفاه الله تعالى على رأس 60 سنة وليس في رأسه ولحيته 20 شعرة بيضاء.
الإمام الترمذي رحمه الله, he mentions in the beginning of the kitab a chapter where he called it بَابُ مَا جَاءَ فِي خَلْقِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Before I go in, inshallah ta'ala, I want to say I'm going to go through 30 points on just this one hadith. 30 points, inshallah ta'ala. So I want us all to be together. I want us to reap and benefit from this hadith and really understand how our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam looked. So the book starts with قال الحافظ. The word الحافظ, what does it mean? الحافظ في اصطلاح المحدثين. The word الحافظ, according to the scholars of hadith, it is من أحاط. It is the person who encompassed, his knowledge encompassed, بمئة ألف حديث, 100,000 أحاديث. You've memorized it. Matnan wa isnadan. You've memorized the wording and you've memorized the chain. 100,000 ahadiths. It's chain and the wording of the hadith. You've memorized it. The chain means from yourself to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And then the wording of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. 100,000 ahadiths. And Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah, he has memorized more than that. If you've memorized 100,000, you have the rights to be called Al-Hafiz. His kunya is Abu Isa Muhammad ibn Isa ibn Sawrat al-Tirmidhi. We already mentioned that the word Tirmidh, it's a city, a qadim, and it falls in a place called Balkh, which is known as Binahri Jayhun, which is in the Shimal of Iran. You can say Tirmidh and you can say Turmudh. Both ways are correct, you can say it. And Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi was attributed to there. Here, rahimahullah, he died Sanata tis'in wa sab'ina wa mi'atayn, 279 Hijriya. And he was 70 years of age when he died. Walahu sab'una sana. Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi was 70 years of age. That's the second benefit that we've taken. So the first benefit that we've taken is what al-Haafidh means, according to the scholars of Hadith. The second benefit that we took, inshallah ta'ala, is the word Tirmidh, who al-Imam al-Tirmidhi was attributed to. What is it? As a side benefit, before I move on to the third point, as a side benefit, I just want to let you all know that the Musannif, al-Imam al-Tirmidhi, in this chaptering, he mentioned 14 hadiths under this chaptering, inshallah ta'ala. 14 hadith, inshallah. We're going to go through each and every one of them, inshallah ta'ala, in details. The third point, bi-idhnillah al-kareem. The third point is, the author, rahimahullah, he said, babu. The author, rahimahullah, he said, babu. The word al-babu is a ismul li madkhali al-amkinati kabab al-madinati wal-dar. The word bab is door. So it's the door. The door is what you used in order to enter the room, in order to enter a house. That's what the word bab is. لكن في عرف العلماء, according to the scholars, when they use the word bab in the books, their intent is لما توصل منه. يعني وفي عرف العلماء البلغاء يقال لما توصل منه إلى المقصود. It is used for whatever will let you reach your objective. That's what it is. Bab. And ulama and the bulagha, when they use it, they use the word bab as whatever will allow you to reach your objective and your aim. Lakin here, al-Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah, he means ma'rifatu ahadith. He's trying to say chapter. The word bab here is chapter. Where you will learn معرفة أحاديث جاءت في بيان خلق رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم that has come regarding the features of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Point number four. The fourth point that inshallah ta'ala I want us to take. So the first point that we took was what is Al-Hafidh. We've taken that. We also took Abu Isa Muhammad ibn Isa ibn Sawrat al-Tirmidhi. Abu Isa Muhammad ibn Isa ibn Sawrat al-Tirmidhi, we explained what Tirmidh means. The third was Babu. I explained to you what Bab means. Now I'm going to go into Ma Ja'a fi Khalqi, the word Khalqi. Let's look at this word together, inshallah. How do we say it together, brothers and sisters? We say Al-Khalq. Al-Khalq. The word Al-Khalq, which is Fath al-Kha'i al-Mu'jamah wa Sukun al-Lami fi al-Lugha. You say Khalq. You place a fatha on the kha and you place a sukoon on the lam, al-khalq. And in the Arabic language, this word al-khalq, yusta'malu, it is used in three meanings. The word al-khalq, which is a fatha on the kha and a sukoon on the lam, it's used in three meanings. The first one is at-taqdeer. The word at-taqdeer means to be predestined something. It's to plan something. Also, it's used as fi ibda'i shay'in min ghayri aslin, to innovate something. When you innovate something that hasn't been done before, it's also the word al-khalq is used for it. And last but not least, ijadu shay'i an shay'in akhara, to create something, to make something from something else. It's also referred to as al-khalq. We have another word which is slightly similar to it, which is al-khuluq, which is bi-dhammatayni. There's a dhamma on the kha and there's a dhamma on the lam. The one before was al-khalq. There was a fatha on the kha and a sukoon on the lam. This one, on the other hand, there's a dhamma on the kha and there's a dhamma on the lam. This one's slightly different. This one is al-khalq and this one is al-khuluq. The difference between them is that al-khuluq is al-tab'u wa-sajiyyah. The khuluq is the person's personality. It is their mannerism. It's the way they carry themselves. The difference between the two is al-khalqu, it refers to as-suratu al-zahira, the outer. Al-khalq, it refers to as-suratu al-zahira, the outer appearance of the person. And al-khuluq deals with what? As-suratul batinah. It refers to the inner appearance of the person. That's the difference between the two. And the author here, rahimahullah, is only going to talk about al-khalq, the outer appearance of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and the way Allah made him look like. That's the fourth benefit. The fifth point that inshallah ta'ala I want us to look at is the Imam rahimahullah, he used the word haddathana. And Imam al-Tirmidhi started the kitab with haddathana. That's what he said. The fifth point is some of the nusakh, some of the copies that I've looked at, it doesn't say haddathana. It says akhbarana. Okay? And some copies, it just says ana. And this is something I want to share with you all, which is what al-Imam al-Nawawi mentioned. Al-Imam al-Nawawi, he said, جَرَتِ الْعَادَةُ بِالِاقْتِصَارِ عَلَى الرَّمْزِ فِي حَدَّثَنَا وَأَخْبَرَنَا. The first point I want to mention here in the fifth benefit is the scholars of hadith sometimes they don't write the entire word of akhbarana or haddathana. We have the word akhbarana and we have the word haddathana. Instead of writing in its totality, they summarize it, they abridge it, they write it in a form that is easy for them. And there's a reason why they do that. So for example, akhbarana, they won't write it. They will just write ana. Or sometimes even just the noon and the alif. They'll just say na. And the word haddathana, they'll only take the tha and the noon and the alif and they will say thana. When you're reading it, you can't say na. You have to say akhbarana because that's what it stands for. You have to look at the books of hadith, it's important. And the word thana is a ramz, it's a symbol for haddathana. You don't read thana, you read haddathana. And the reason why the scholars of hadith used to do that was because papers were very expensive for them. You couldn't get papers like the way we can. And so any way to shorten things and to subtract or omit something would be done. So Nawawi mentions the ada of the scholars is when it comes to hadathana akhbarana is that they use a ramz. That's one point, inshallah, I want you to all take, inshallah ta'ala, from the fifth point, which is the copy that says ana is basically the same as akhbarana. And now this copy that we're reading from, and the one, as I mentioned in the introduction, the one I'm going to be using for now is the one that's done by Mahir Yasin al-Fahl with the taqdeem of Bashar Awad Ma'ruf. Darul Gharb published it. That's the one that's the best so far. There are mistakes also in that copy. Our Sheikh Ahmed Mahmoud al-Markawi, Ahmed Yareh, is currently working on Shama'il al-Muhammadiyah. He told me that he's finished all of it. He's fully done it. He just needs to do the final and last muqabala. Just the final last muqabala. And I asked him if I could help him so we can get it done quickly so we can inshallah ta'ala bi-idhnillahi al-bari. So we can inshallah ta'ala bring it out in time for us to inshallah use that copy of his. His copy is better. He's relied on more makhtutat, more manuscripts than any previous muhaqqiq has used. So anyways, the akhbarana that was used or the haddathana that was used, I want to inshallah ta'ala share. I've shared one benefit inshallah ta'ala. I want to share another benefit with you all, which is there a difference between haddathana and akhbarana? Since there's those two copies that we see, those two copies, they kind of point out, they kind of show that Tirmidhi probably said both. So what do we do? According to the early scholars of hadith, Kazuhri, Malik ibn Anas, Ibn Uyayna, Yahya ibn Sa'id al-Qattan, and other great scholars, and Akthar al-Hijaziyin, they don't see a difference between akhbarana and haddathana. They don't. Ind al-Mutaqaddimin, كالزهري ومالك وابن عيينة ويحيى بن سعيد القطان and the majority of the حجازيين and also the كوفيين, the overwhelming majority of the كوفيين like أبي حنيفة and his two students Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani and Abu al-Qadi Abu Yusuf. And this is also the Amalul Maghariba. This is the stance that the Ahlul Maghrib believe. Lakin, there's another group of scholars from the Salaf who saw something different, like Ibn Jurayj and Al-Auza'i and Al-Shafi'i and the majority of Ahlul Sharq. They believe there is a difference between it. And this became the stance of the Mutaakhirin, the late scholars of the scholars of Hadith. They saw it to be different. That the Siyagh al-Tahammul, Siyagh al-Ada', sorry, of Akhbarana and Hadathana, they saw a difference between them. So what's the difference according to them? The difference is, Hadathana is when you hear bima yalfidhu bihi shaykh. وَسَمِعَ الرَّاوِيُّ عَنْهُ. When the teacher reads and the student hears it from the teacher. That's حَدَّثَنَا. And أَخْبَرَنَا is that which the student reads بِمَا يَقْرَأُ التِّلْمِيدُ عَلَى الشَّيْخِ. The student reads it on the teacher. And that's the view of Ibn Jurayj, as I mentioned, and Al-Auza'i and Al-Shafi'i and Jumhur Ahl al-Sharq. And I mentioned لَا مُشَاحَةَ فِي الْإِصْطِلَاحِ. لَا مُشَاحَةَ فِي الْإِصْطِلَاحِ. Specifically here, the tahdith and the ikhbar, whether it's the same or different, it doesn't change anything because both of them, they are sarih in siyagh al-tahammul. They're clear cut when that these two people heard from each other. That's all that matters. Whether they're the same or not, it doesn't matter. Like in an, it matters to us. An is another one we're going to talk about another time, inshallah ta'ala. The sixth benefit, inshallah ta'ala, is the author, rahimahullah, mentioned the narrator here, Abu Raja Qutaybah ibn Sa'eed. So each narrator, we're going to take who he is, inshallah ta'ala. Qutaybah, his kunya is Abu Raja ibn Sa'eed ibn Jamil al-Thaqafi. There are disputes regarding his name. Some scholars, they call him Yahya. And some scholars, they call him Ali. There's a dispute. Qutaybah ibn Sa'eed, is his name Yahya or is his name Ali? There's a dispute. Lakin his laqab, his nickname is Qutaybah. That is his nickname. He is Sa'id ibn Jamil al-Thaqafi. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, rahimahullah, in his Sir Alam al-Nubala, he said about him, Shaykh al-Islam, al-Muhaddith, al-Imam, al-Thiqah, al-Jawwal, Rayatul Islam. These are descriptions that are very high. وشيخ الإسلام المحدث الإمام الثقة الجوال الراوية الإسلامي. He called him شيخ الإسلام. He called him المحدث, a scholar of hadith. الإمام, a person who's followed. A person who's followed. الثقة, someone whose integrity is on point. His honor is on point. Reliable individual. And he's also راوية الجوال. الجوال, someone who traveled the world to seek knowledge. The word الجوال, he means he travels. Rawiyatul Islam, he's the narrator of Al-Islam, one of the narrators of Al-Islam. When he said Jawwal, where did he travel to? Al-Imam Qutaybah, Abu Raja ibn Sa'id ibn Jamil al-Thaqafi, he traveled to Al-Iraq. He traveled to Al-Medina. All of this for the knowledge of Hadith. He traveled to Makkah. He traveled to Al-Sham. He traveled to Misra, Egypt. And he traveled to Al-Kufa, six places. He traveled to all of those places, rahimahullah. And he heard from many people. Yeah, and he took knowledge from many people. I'm going to mention some. He took from Imam Malik ibn Anas, rahimahullah. That was his teacher. He took from him. He took from the Imam of the people of Egypt, Al-Layth ibn Sa'ad. He also took from Sufyan ibn Uyayna. Wa khalqan kathiran min al-a'lami. He took from many scholars of hadith. Many of them, rahimahullah. Also, many scholars narrated from him. Like Al-Imam al-Bukhari narrated from him. Imam al-Muslim narrated from him. Abu Dawood narrated from him. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i narrated from him. And Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi narrated from him. These five Imams that I mentioned, al-Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawood, al-Nasa'i, and Tirmidhi, they narrated from him in their books and they narrated a lot from him. Qutaybah ibn Sa'eed is filled up with these books. And there are many other people who narrated from him. He, rahimahullah, he was born sanata 48 wa 100. He was born 148 Hijriya. He was literally born the year Al-A'mash died. Sulaiman ibn Mihran al-A'mash. Qutaybah was born the year that Sulaiman ibn Mihran died, al-A'mash. And this is something I'm collecting, inshallah ta'ala. I'm trying to collect in a little daftar, a little book, which I want to talk about a year where a scholar was born and another scholar died. Qutaybah ibn Sa'eed is one of them. The year he was born was the year Sulaiman ibn Mihran al-A'mash, a great scholar, died. And the same was is al-Imam al-Shafi'i, Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i. He was born 150 Hijriah. And that same year that Shafi'i was born was the year al-Imam Abu Hanifa died, rahimahullah ta'ala. So an Imam was born and an Imam died. Qutaybah ibn Sa'eed, he died, rahimahullah, when the year was 240 Hijriah. Sanata 40 wa 200. 240 Hijriah he passed away. وَكَانَ ثِقَّةً ثَبْتًا. He was a person who was reliable. That's a praise for his adala. And it's a condition. When you want to take the narration of a scholar or a person in hadith, he has to be thiqah. He has to be on point when it comes to his adala, his integrity. Also, he was ثَبْتًا, which is a praise for his memorization. He was accurate in his memorization. رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى رَحْمَةً وَاسِعَةً. Now we're going to go into the seventh point, inshallah ta'ala, which is Malik ibn Anas. Qutaybah ibn Sa'eed, Abu Raja, he narrated from who? Malik ibn Anas. Who is al-Imam Malik? Rahimahullah ta'ala. Even though Malik is well known and is a great scholar of hadith, but we're still going to go through each Imam so you have an understanding of who they are. Malik ibn Anas, his name is Malik ibn Anas ibn Malik al-Madani, Abu Abdullah Malik ibn Anas ibn Malik ibn Abi Amir ibn Amr ibn al-Harith ibn Ghayman ibn Khuthayl ibn Amr ibn al-Harith, wa huwa dhu Asbah ibn Auf ibn Malik ibn Zayd ibn Shaddad ibn Zur'ata, wa huwa Himyar al-Asghar al-Himyari, thumma al-Asbahi al-Madani, Halif bani Taym ibn Quraysh, فهم حلفاء عثمان أخي طلحة بن عبيد الله أحد العشرة. الإمام مالك, he is حميري, and then after that he is أصبحي. He is known as what? إمام دار الهجرة, the great scholar, one of the four imams that are followed in madhab. الإمام الذهبي, we said about him, شيخ الإسلام حجة الأمة إمام دار الهجرة. He is شيخ الإسلام حجة الأمة. He is the proof of this religion, and he's called إمام دار الهجرة. The reason why he's called Imam Dar al-Hijra is because he was the Imam of the place the Prophet migrated to, which was Medina. His contemporaries, the people that were like him, or that they were his level, they were his age, the people of his age, are Ma'mar ibn Rashid and Ibn Jurayj and Abu Hanifa and Amr ibn al-Harith and al-Awza'i and Shu'bah ibn al-Hajjaj, Abu Bistam al-Ataki and Sufyan al-Thawri and Juwayriyat ibn Asma' and Layth ibn Sa'd and Hamad ibn Zayd. These were his peers. And Ismail ibn Ja'far and Sufyan ibn Uyayna, Allah ibn Mubarak and Al-Dawardi and Ibn Abi Zinad and Sulaiman ibn Ulayyah and Yahya ibn Abi Zaidata and Abu Ishaq al-Fazari. These people were Malik's Aqaran. Even though he was, without a shadow of a doubt, and unique from all of them. But these show you and give you understanding of the time of an Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala. Malik heard from many scholars, many scholars. And Imam Malik, he took knowledge from Nafi' and Sa'id al-Maqburi and Amr ibn Abdullah ibn Zubayr ibn al-Munkadir and al-Zuhri and Abdullah ibn Dinar. And his chain, Imam Malik, according to Imam al-Bukhari, is considered to be what? Asahhu al-Asanid. One of the strongest chain of narration in Hadith. Malik and Nafi' and Ibn Umar, according to Bukhari. Even though we take the opinion, إمساكنا عن حكمنا على سند بأنه أصح مطلقا وقد خاض به قوم فقيل مالك عن نافع بما رواه عنه الناسك. We stay away from indulging into this discussion that this chain is the best and the most authentic chain. There are differences of opinions on that issue. الإمام الذهبي رحمه الله said about الإمام مالك وطلب مالك العلم. He said الإمام مالك sought knowledge. وهو ابن بضع عشر سنة. And he was what? 10 or something. Pay attention. And Imam Malik, he started when he was what? 10, 11, 12, 13. To seek knowledge. Yeah, he finished the Qur'an, he memorized the book of Allah, then he came to seek knowledge. وَتَأَهَّلَ لِلْفُتْيَا ذَهَبِي says. He became, يعني, he had the rights to give fatwa. وَجَلَسَ لِلْإِفَادَةِ and he sat down to benefit the people. وَلَهُ إِحْدَى وَعِشِرُونَ سَنَةً when he was 21 years old. And Imam Malik was 21 years of age when he was given the rights. And he was entitled, رحمه الله رحمة واسعة, to give fatwa. Brothers, we're talking about a time when Ma'mar ibn Rashid and Ibn Jurayj and Abu Hanif and Amr ibn al-Harith and Al-Awza'i and Shu'bat ibn al-Hajjaj, Abu Bistam al-Ataki and Sufyan al-Thawri and Sufyan ibn Uyayna and يعني الليث بن سعد and حماد بن زيد and إسماعيل بن جعفر and داوردي and ابن أبي الزناد and ابن عليا يحيى بن أبي زائدة and أبو إسحاق الفزاري. These people are alive. أئمة الهدى ومصابيح الدجى were alive. It wasn't a time when a person can just claim knowledge. 21 years, رحمه الله رحمة واسعة, he sat down to give fatwa. يعني ذهبي saying وتأهل للفتيا, he was يعني entitled to give fatwa, رحمه الله. وحدث عنه جماعة, many people narrated from him. وهو حي شاب طري, he was a youth, a young man. وقصده طلبة العلم من الآفاق, students of knowledge came to Imam al-Dhahabi from Imam Malik ibn Anas from all over the world. في آخر دولة أبي جعفر المنصور, especially at the ending of the government of Abi Ja'far al-Mansur. وما بعد ذلك, and even after that. وازدحموه عليه في خلافة الرشيد. And the time of Harun al-Rashid, they were, people were crowded around him. وإلى أن مات, until he died. الإمام الشافعي, he said, وصدق وبرى. Shafi'i was right. And he shows his obedience to his teacher. He said, إذا ذكر العلماء فمالك النجم. If the scholars are mentioned, الإمام مالك is the star. The highest of them. رحمه الله تعالى. الإمام Dhabi mentioned the story of Imam Malik. And I want inshallah ta'ala to extract a benefit from it, inshallah ta'ala. And Imam Dhabi, we mentioned Isir Ala ibn Bala, Ibn Sa'd said, قال حدثنا محمد ibn Umar, قال سمعت مالكا يقول. And Imam Malik mentioned this. He said, لما حج المنصور, Abi Ja'far al-Mansur, when he did Hajj, دعاني. Malik did Hajj with the Muslims at that time. And Abi Ja'far al-Mansur said, I want Malik to be brought to me. So Imam Malik came to Abi Ja'far al-Mansur. فَدَخَلْتُ عَلَيْهِ, I entered onto Abi Ja'far al-Mansur. And then he said, فَحَادَثْتُهُ, we discussed and we had a conversation. وَسَأَلَنِي, he asked me issues and things. فَأَجَبْتُ, I responded to him. He asked me about my life, my situation, my health and everything. And I responded to him. فَقَالَ, he then said to me, عَزَمْتُ, I've made a decision. Abi Ja'far al-Mansur, he said, I have made a decision. أَنْ أَمُرَ بِكُتُوبِكَ هَذِهِ, that your book here, يعني المُوَطَّى, the كتاب المُوَطَّى, that I take that book. And what do? فَتُنْسَخُ نُسَخًا, copies are made from it. ثُمَّ, after that, I what أَبْعَثَ إِلَى كُلِّ مِصْرٍ مِنْ أَمْصَارِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ, I take it to every single part of the world. بنسخة, a copy is taken and it's sent to a part of the world. وَآمُرُهُمْ, and I command the people. يعني I make a copy of your muwatta. I ask people to make copies of it, a lot of copies. There wasn't typing up, or there wasn't a printer. It was nusakh, they were called. They were scribers. They would scribe from the kitab. They would sit down and they would look at the muwatta and they would write it. I make a lot of copies. And then what do I do? ثُمَّ أَبْعَثَ إِلَى كُلِّ مِصْرٍ مِنْ أَمْصَارِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ بِنُسْخَةٍ, and every land of the Muslims, I send a copy. وَآمُرُهُمْ أَن يَعْمَلُوا بِمَا فِيهَا, and I command the people to act upon the muwatta. And if the Qur'an is used, and the muwatta is the hadith of the Prophet, that's used. وَيَدَعُوا, and the people leave off. وَيَدَعُوا, and they leave off مَا سِوَى ذَلِكَ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ الْمُحْدَثِ, they leave off all of the other introduced knowledge after that. فَإِنِّي رَأَيْتُ أَبِي جَعْفَرِ الْمَنْصُورِ saying, I saw. فَإِنِّي رَأَيْتُ أَصْلَ الْعِلْمِ رِوَايَةُ أَهْلِ الْمَدِينَةِ وَعِلْمُهُمْ, I've seen that the foundation of knowledge, the real meaning of knowledge, is the knowledge of the people of Medina, the narration of the people of Medina. That's what I've come to the conclusion. Abi Ja'far al-Mansur is saying this. Look at what Al-Imam Malik said. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, this shows you what an imam he was. He said, قلت يا أمير المؤمنين, O the leader of the believers, لا تفعل, don't do that. فَإِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ سِيقَتْ إِلَيْهِمْ أَقَاوِيلُ, the people, views have been brought to them. وَسَمِعُوا أَحَادِيثَ, and they've heard narrations. وَرَوَوْا رِوَايَاتٍ, and they've narrated narrations. وَأَخَذَ كُلُّ قَوْمٍ, and every people have taken بِمَسِيقَ إِلَيْهِمْ, whatever was brought to them. وَعَمِلُوا بِهِ, and they acted upon it. وَدَانُوا بِهِ, and they've taken their religion as that. مِنْ اخْتِلَافِ أَصْحَابِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, they took the different views from the companions. وَغَيْرِهِمَ, rather than them. The people have received views and they've chosen from those views what they thought to be most accurate and most strongest. And they've made their religion. This is, and the difference is here, it goes back to the Sahabas. وَغَيْرِهِمْ وَإِنَّ رَدَّهُمْ عَمَّا اَعْتَقَدُوهُ شَدِيدٌ, and it's very hard to take the people back from what they believe in. فَدَعِ النَّاسَ, leave the people. وَمَا هُمْ عَلَيْهِ, and leave them what they are upon. وَمَا اخْتَارَ أَهْلُ كُلِّ بَلَدٍ لِأَنفُسِهِمْ, leave every people whatever they want to believe. Let them believe what they want to believe. And let them hold on to what they want to hold on to from those views of the companions. Allahu Akbar. And then Al-Imam Abi Ja'far Al-Mansur, the Imam Amir Al-Mu'mineen, he said to Al-Imam Malik, he said to him, لَعَمْرِي, I swear by Allah, لَوْ طَاوَعْتَنِي, if you were to obey me in this, لَأَمَرْتُ بِذَلِك, I would have commanded the scribes to start scribing from now. I would have told them, each and every one of you, go and scribe the muwatta of Al-Imam Malik and spread it to the earth and everywhere. And I would have imposed, I would have forced on everybody to take their religion from the muwatta. By the way, the muwatta, what does it have in it? It has the hadith of Rasulullah. And of course, in there is the views of Al-Imam Malik and his opinions and his tawjihat and his istinbatat. Of course, there is that definitely is the case. But the majority of it is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Ma'a dhalika, he didn't want to force it on anybody. So these masa'id, which are ijtihadiyya, there are differences of opinion, there are valid differences of opinion for you to force people to take your view. It shows you haven't really understood the reality of knowledge. For example, the issue of taraweeh, whether it's 11 rak'ah or it's more than that, these are masa'id ijtihadiyya, valid difference of opinion, making this all the time a problem. It's not right. Where you put your hand in the salah, wahakada, these issues, whether the niqab is wajib or not, whether abandoning the prayer or yani if it's kufr akbar or not, these are valid difference of opinion. The salaf differed, and I can reassure you, you won't be the first person to bring this khilaf to an end. You won't be able to. The scholars have differed on the issue of niqab, whether it's wajib or not, and it's a valid difference of opinion. The scholars have differed upon the abandoning of the prayer if the person does it out of laziness. There's a valid difference of opinion here. The scholars have differed upon the raka'at of Salatul Taraweeh, for example. And is it restricted to 11 or is it more? There's a difference of opinion. There's a valid difference of opinion. There's a difference of opinion amongst the scholars. Where do you place your hand on your chest or your lower or up? Is a difference of opinion. Valid difference of opinion. When you pray the salah, do you put your knees down first or do you put your hands down? Valid difference of opinion. Whether you move your finger when you're in the tashahud is a valid difference of opinion. These are valid difference of opinion that the scholars have had. No group should force on the other group to have to take his opinion. And no group should make tabdi' or someone based on their opinion that they've chosen to take. This is something Al-Imam Malik rahimahullah has pointed out and shown. Al-Imam Malik, he was born Sanata 93 Hijriyah, as Yahya ibn Bukayrin and others have mentioned. And what is the funny or the most amazing thing that was mentioned is that his mother carried him, rahimahullah, 3 years. And in her womb, she carried Imam Malik in her womb for 3 years. It's mentioned in his biography. And Imam Malik, rahimahullah, he died صبيحة 14 من ربيع الأول سنة 79. He died the year 100 and 79 Hijriya rahimahullah ta'ala. He died in the month of Rabi' al-Awwal. On the 14th of Rabi' al-Awwal in the morning, he passed away rahimahullah ta'ala. Rahmatan wasi'ah. Now inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to go into the 8th point of the hadith, which is Rabi'ah. The author rahimahullah mentioned that Imam Maliki took this from who? Rabi'at ibn Abi Abdurrahman. Rabi'at al-Ra'i. Who is Rabi'at al-Ra'i? Who is Rabi'at ibn Abdurrahman? Rahimahullah. His name is Rabi'at al-Ra'i. He's known as Rabi'at ibn Abi Abdurrahman. Some scholars, they call him Farrukh al-Tamimiyu Abu Uthman. And some scholars, they call him Abu Abdurrahman al-Qurashiyu al-Taymiyu Mawlahu. He's well known as the name Rabi'at al-Ra'i. That's what he's known as. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, he said about Ibn Sir Alam al-Nubala, Al-Imam Mufti al-Madinati wa Alim al-Waqti. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi mentions that he was the Imam, he's the Mufti of Medina, and he was al-Alim, a scholar of his time. He heard from Anas ibn Malik, Al-Sa'ib ibn Yazid, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, Al-Harith ibn Bilal ibn al-Harith, Yazid Mawla al-Munba'ithi, Hamdalat ibn Qays al-Zuraqi, Ata ibn Yasar, Al-Qasib ibn Muhammad, Sulaiman ibn Yasar, Salim ibn Abdullah, Abdul Malik ibn Sa'id ibn Suwayd al-Ansari, and Muhammad ibn Yahya ibn Habban, and Abdul Rahman al-A'raji, and many other people. Many people have narrated from him, like Yahya ibn Sa'id al-Ansari, and Sulaiman al-Taymi, and Suhail ibn Abi Salihin, and Suhail ibn Abi Salihin narrated from him, and is also from his Aqaran, and Ismail ibn Umayyah, and Al-Awza'i, and Shu'ba, and many other great scholars. And also Al-Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala. His birth is not known when he was born, but he died when the year was 136 He died in Medina, 136 Hijriya. Rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'a. The ninth one is, the ninth point that we're going to take is, Rabi'a narrated this hadith from who? He narrated it from Anas ibn Malik. He narrated it from who? Anas ibn Malik. And I already mentioned, Rabi'a al-Ra'i took this hadith from Anas ibn Malik. Anas ibn Malik, his name is Anas ibn Malik ibn Nadr ibn Dhamdam ibn al-Ansari. Anas ibn Malik is from the companions who are called the Ansar. The companions are two groups. Muhajirin are the people who migrated to Medina, and the residents of Medina. The residents of Medina are called Ansar, and the ones who migrated are called the Muhajirin. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, he said about Anas ibn Malik, he said, Al-Imam al-Mufti al-Muqri'u al-Muhaddithu Rawiyatu al-Islami Abu Hamzat al-Ansari Al-Khazrajiyu Al-Najjariyu Al-Madaniyu Khadimu Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Wa qarabatuhu minan nisai Wa tilmiduhu wa taba'uhu Wa akhiru ashabihi mawta. Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu ta'ala anhu is a noble companion. He was considered to be one of the last companions who died and passed away. He's from the people of Ansar. Specifically, Ansar is two main tribes, Aws and Khazraj. He was from the people of Khazraj. He heard from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and he also took from Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Mu'adh and Usayd ibn al-Hudayr and Abi Talha. And he took from his mother, Umm Sulaym bint al-Milhan. Umm Sulaym is the famous woman who married the noble companion Abu Talha. And because Anas' father, Malik, he died in Sham, he didn't take Islam, and he didn't die in a pleasant way. His mother remarried Sulaym. She remarried, and I spoke about her story in one of the previous series that I did. He also narrated from Ubadah ibn Samit and Abi Dharr and Malik ibn Sa'sa'at and Abu Hurairah and Fatimata binti Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He narrated from many people. He's considered to be from the seven Yani Sahaba who are called the Mukthirin, who narrated the most. There are seven companions who narrated the most ahadith from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. A poet brought them in a line or two lines of poetry. He said, Sab'un min as-sahbi fawqa al-alfi qad naqalu min al-hadithi al-mukhtari khayri mudar. Abu Hurayrata, Sa'adun, Jabirun, Anasu, Siddiqatu, Wabnu Abbasin, Kadabnu Umar. These are the Sahaba who narrated the most. The Messenger made dua for Anas ibn Malik. Anas ibn Malik, and he said, Da'ali Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet made dua for me. And the dua that the Prophet made for me, he said to me, Allahumma akthir ma lahu wa walada. Oh Allah, increase his wealth for Anas, for him, Anas ibn Malik. Wa atil hayatahu, and lengthen his life for him. Anas ibn Malik became excessively rich. He mentions it himself. He said, فَاللَّهُ أَكْثَرَ مَالِي. Allah, he increased my wealth for me. حَتَّى إِنَّ كَرْمَ لِي لَتَحْمِلُ فِي السَّنَةِ مَرَّتَيْنِ. يعني, his caravan was, يعني, people's caravan travels once a year. His one was twice. And also, the children that he had, they said he had, وَوُلِدَ لِصُلْبِ مِئَةٌ وَسِتَّةٌ. 106 kids he had. Just from him. What his children gave birth to, hadith wa la haraj. Just from the dua of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. The 10th point, inshallah ta'ala, is the statement that he said, annahu sami'ahu. Annahu sami'ahu, that he heard. What does annahu sami'ahu mean here? And what is the aim that the Imam rahimahullah, and Imam Tirmidhi mentioned? Yani he means annahu sami'a rabi'ata anasan. That Al-Imam Malik heard that Rabee’ah heard from Anas ibn Malik. يعني Rabee’ah took this hadith from Anas ibn Malik بطريق التحديث لا بالإخبار. Again, Anas, how was this hadith taken from him? يعني how did Rabee’ah ibn Abi Abd al-Rahman, how did he hear this hadith from Anas? Did he hear it? Did he use the word an? No. He heard it through what? حَدَّثَنَا. Why? Because Anas is the one who read it. Anas is the one who said it. And this I want to point out. The scholars of hadith, look how detailed they are. They are so detailed, subhanAllah, they will tell you how this narration was heard. Who said it? Was it the student that read it and the teacher heard? Or was it the teacher that said it and the student heard? Here it says, يعني أي سمع ربيعة أنسا. ربيعة heard this hadith from Anas. بطريق التحديث, Anas is the one who narrated it, and Rabi'ah was listening. Then the hadith says kaana. It mentions the first word, it says it's kaana. Kaana in the Arabic language yufidu takrari lughatan. In the Arabic language, the word kaana, it benefits repetition. That's, this thing happens. If somebody says kaana, it means this happens very often. وَقِيلَ, and some scholars, they said, no, كَانَ benefits repetition, عُرْفًا, not لُغَةً. Because we know, when we study أصول الفقه, there are ثلاثة حقائق. There are three realities of things. There's a حقيقة لغوية, حقيقة عرفية, and حقيقة شرعية. There's those three حقائق. For example, the word الصلاة, the حقيقة لغوية is that it's a dua, but like in the حقيقة الشرعية is that it is what? It's عبادة مفتتحة بالتكبير مختتمة بالتسليم يعني أقوال وأفعال يعني وهكذا. It's عبادة, you have to say Allahu Akbar, you read الفاتحة, you read وهكذا. There's also a حقيقة عرفية, عرف, meaning the custom of the people. Like the word الدابة. The word دابة in the Arabic language, it's كل ما يدب على الأرض من الحشرات والحيوانات, صح؟ Everything that walks on this earth is a dabba. That's why Allah said in the ayah, وَمَا مِنْ دَابَّةٍ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا. That there's no ride, there's no beast on this earth except that Allah provides for it. The word dabba is anything that moves on this earth. لكن لحقيقة عرفية, يعني according to the people's custom, the word dabba is known as, for example, if I'd say to you, استويتُ على الدابة, you will understand me to mean a camel or a donkey or a horse, وهكذا. صح؟ Because that's حقيقة عرفية. على كل حال, the word كان, is it, does it show repetition in the Arabic language or does it show repetition in the عرف? There's a discussion amongst the scholars. And some scholars, they even say that the word كان لا يفيد التكرار مطلقا. That the word kana does not even benefit repetition at all. And this is the view that you can say, it's the view of the aktharuna, the majority of the scholars actually. Okay? Very good. Now I'm going to move on to the next point. I'm going to move on to the next point, which is the 12th point, which is, we mentioned the word kana. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam laysa bit-tawili. This whole sentence, the 12th point, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam laysa bit-tawili, all of that, it's a khabarun likana. If grammatically it falls in the context of the khabar for kana. Kana has an ism and it also has a what? Khabar. It falls in the place of a, it falls, the whole jumla is a khabaru kana. The third, 13th point, inshallah ta'ala, that I want to take, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem, is the word ba'in. The word ba'in. The word ba'in, what does it mean? So the hadith mentioned, kana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam laysa bit-tawil al-ba'ini. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was not. So we're now going to go into the Prophet's description. Kana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger was not laysa bit-tawil al-ba'ini. What does tawil al-ba'ini mean? I'm going to explain that inshallah. The word al-ba'in is the way you should say it. It should be ba'in. There's a hamza there. And we say that the person who said ba'in with a ya, that's a wahm. Okay? Because it comes from the ismu fa'il of min bana. That's what it comes from. And the word bana means dhahara ala ghayrihi. It's when something becomes more clearer from the rest. And some scholars, they said, no, it means bana, it comes from, and it means min bana bima'na ba'uda, when something is far. When something is apparent from something else, the rest, they say bana. يعني ظهرة. Also they say bana, it can also mean bima'na ba'uda, when something is far. When something is ba'id, and it becomes far. And it's correct to use it both here. And there's no problem. Both meanings it can take. Yani the word, the Prophet ﷺ wasn't so tall that he was apparent from the rest of the people. That's correct. And also, if you use the word bima'na ba'udana, it means annahu lam yakun ba'idan min at-tawassuti. The Prophet wasn't far from being in the middle. And it was middle. Salawatullah was in his yani how tall he was, the Prophet was in the middle. Even though some narrations are going to show us later, inshallah ta'ala, كَانَ طُولُهُ يَظْهَرْ, that he was a bit closer to being taller, صَلَوَاتُ اللَّهِ وَسَلَامُ عَلَيْهِ. So that's what the word لَيْسَ بِالطَّوِيلِ الْبَائِنِ means. Okay, we've taken what الطَّوِيلِ الْبَائِنِ. Point number 14 that I want, inshallah ta'ala, for us to take is وَلَا بِالْقَصِيرِ. The Prophet was not excessively tall. We've taken that. Also the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he is not يعني short. It means أنه كان متوسطا بين الطول والقصري. The Prophet was in the middle of being not tall or short. He was in the middle, عليه الصلاة والسلام. Even though I mentioned that he صلى الله عليه وسلم was what? مائلا إلى الطول. He was closer to being taller, عليه الصلاة والسلام. As Imam al-Bayhaqi narrated that narration. Point number 15 that inshallah ta'ala I want to mention here, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem, is what is wala bil abyat al-amhaqi. So far what we've taken is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what the word yani ba'in means, and the fact that the Prophet was very tall. No, he wasn't. Alayhi salatu wasalam. And he wasn't very short. We've taken that. We're also going to take now is wala bil abyat al-amhaqi. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was not abiyat al-amhaqi. What does it mean, al-abiyat al-ahmaq? Amhaq, sorry. What does al-abiyat al-amhaq mean? It means that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam laysa shadeed al-bayad, ay shadeed al-bayad. He wasn't excessively white, pale. Amhaqi means shadeed al-bayad. al-khali an al-humrati wal-nur. There are some people who are very white. They have no, it's like they've got no blood inside them. And they've got, they're not glowing. The Prophet wasn't like that, alayhi salatu wasalam. The Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he was white. لَكِنْ كَانَ بَيَاضُهُ نَيِّرًا مُشْرَبًا بِحُمْرَةً. The Prophet ﷺ's color was مُشْرَبٌ بِالْحُمْرَةً. He had some redness to him, salawatu Allahi wa salam, some redness to him, alayhi salatu wa salam. وَلَا بِالْآدَمِ, which is the 16th point. The word Adam, it comes from the word udmatu, al-udmah. And al-udmah, it means شِدَّةُ sumra, when excessively black. The messenger was not excessively white, pale, alayhi salatu wa salam, and he wasn't excessively black, alayhi salatu wa salam. He was a manzilatun bayna al-bayadi wa-sawadi. The Prophet was in the middle. He wasn't too black and he wasn't too dark. He wasn't too black and he wasn't too white, alayhi salatu wa salam, in the middle. This is something very important that we understand. Nabiullahi Muhammad, the same way that his outer appearance was in the middle, his religion is also in the middle. His personality was in the middle, alayhi salatu wasalam, that wasat. You're always going to see that from him, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, because Allah perfected him from outside and inside, sallallahu alayhi wasalam. So the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he had in him, something that took him away from being excessively white, and he also wasn't black, alayhi salatu wasalam. He was, salawatullahi wasalam alayhi, a bayad mushrabun bil humra. He was, kana bayaduhu nayyiran mushrabun bi humratin. He had some color to him, salawatullahi wasalam alayhi. Okay, al-imamu ibn Hajar al-Asqalaniyu, he says that when we look at all of the narrations that have come, that negate, he says, the bayad, he says the Prophet is not white, it's referring to the pale whiteness. And the narration that we find that negates the Prophet ﷺ being black is referring to being excessively dark. He wasn't that, alayhi salatu wasalam. He was white that had color in it, he was red. He had red in him, blood in him, sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Now we know how how tall he was. We also know now, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how his complexion was, the color of his face. We now know it, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. Each narration, I want you to all to pay attention. This is the narration of Anas ibn Malik. Each sahabi, when he explains it, he says something. Very important that you bring it all together. So we've taken what it means, bil-adami. Now we go into wala bil-ja'di. What does al-ja'di mean? That's mentioned in the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, bil-ja'di. Ja'di means al-ju'udah, it means wa hiya fi sha'ri an la yatakassaru takassuran tamman wa la yastarsilu. Al-ju'udah means his hair was not curly, alayhi salatu wasalam. He wasn't, sallallahu alayhi wasalam. He didn't have curly hairs. His hair wasn't curly. And his hair wasn't, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, also وَلَا بِالْجَعْدَدِ الْقَطَطِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is the 18th point now, his hair wasn't excessively curly, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it wasn't also excessively straight. Some people have very straight hair. He wasn't, alayhi salatu wa sallam, which is the 19th point, which is وَلَا بِالْسَبْطِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his hair was not sabt. Sabt means someone whose hair is, it's the opposite of ju'udah. He huwa al-imtidadu alladhi laysa fihi taqa'udun. It is the hair that's so straight that there's no curve to it at all. Wala nutu'un asla. The Prophet's hair wasn't like that. His sha'ar, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, mutawassitun bayna al-ju'udati wa-subutati. The Prophet's hair was in between curly and straight. It was in the middle. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His height wasn't excessive. He wasn't too tall. He wasn't too short, he was in the middle. His color, his complexion wasn't too black. And it wasn't too white, he was in the middle. Alayhi salatu wasalam. Salawatullahi wa sallam. His hair wasn't excessively curly. And it wasn't excessively straight. He was in the middle. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Point number 20, inshallah ta'ala, that we want to take from the hadith is the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the statement where it says, ba'athahu Allah ta'ala. Point number 20. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam. This is a khabarul li, it's a second khabar for kana. We've mentioned the first one, which was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, laysa bit-tawili. That was the first khabar. And then now this is the second khabar for kana. Means, ay arsalahu Allahu, Allah sent Nabillah Muhammad, arsalahu al-haqqu, Allah sent him, ila al-khalqi, to the people, for what reason? Lil-nubuwati, prophecy, wal-risala, and with a message, wa tablighi al-ahkami wal-hukmi lil-umma, and also conveying the ahkam wal-hukmi lil-ummati, and also to pass on to the people the ruling and the wisdoms of things. Salawatullah wa salam alayhi. Point number 21 that we want to take from the hadith, inshallah ta'ala, is ala ra'si arba'ina sana. The Prophet was sent out, point number 21, he was sent out alayhi salatu wa salam as a prophet at the age of what? 40. And this is strengthened by the riwayah Sahih Bukhari, which mentions unzila alayhi ayil wahi wa huwa ibn 40 sana. And the shurrah of the hadith mentioned that the murad here means bira'si at-taraf al-akhirati minhu lima 'alayhi jumhur min ahli siyar. That this is the what? It's the edge of the ending of his 40 salawatullah wa salam alayhi, as the scholars mentioned rahimahullah. Yani the Prophet became a prophet when he finished, when he's just about to finish 40 salawatullah. It's not when he came into it. Okay? That's what he means. Now we're going to go into point 22, which is fa'aqama. Fa'aqama here means ay ba'd al-bi'tha. The Prophet stayed after being a prophet, he stayed in Mecca. And he stayed in Mecca. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And how long did he stay in Mecca? The narration mentions 10 years, which is the 23rd point. Ashara sana, 10 years he stayed in Mecca. But we know with the authentic narrations and everything that the Prophet stayed in Mecca for how long? 13 years. This is called, according to the scholars, it means iqtasara ala al-aqdi wa taraka al-kasra. Scholars, they do that, and the Arabs generally do that. We have the kitab Arba'un al-Nawawiyya, and Imam al-Nawawi mentioned in the 42 hadiths. He mentioned in the 42 hadiths, rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'ah. With that being said though, it's called Arba'un al-Nawiyya. There's 42 hadiths in there, and it's called Arba'un al-Nawiyya. The scholars, they get rid of those little extra numbers, 3 and 4, and they don't mention it. They cut that off, and they round it off to the nearest. So here, that's why he said 10, but it's 13. Point, inshallah ta'ala, 24, that I want to mention, inshallah ta'ala, here. The 24th point is what is mentioned in the narration, وَبِالْ مَدِينَةِ عَشْرَ سِنِينَ. And there's no dispute amongst the scholars that the Prophet stayed in Mecca for 10, Medina for 10 years. There is no khilaf. Arbab al-Siyar, ulama Siyar, all of them agree that he stayed in Medina for 10 years. Salawatullahi wa salamun alayhi. وَتَوَفَّاهُ, which is the 25th point, inshallah ta'ala, which is وَتَوَفَّاهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, Allah took him. The 25th point is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he took his life. And فَتَوَفَّاهُ means أي قَبَضَ رُوحَهُ. The word فَتَوَفَّى is used for death. As Allah mentioned in the Qur'an, الله يتوفى الأنفس حين موتها والتي لم تمت في منامها. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says وَاللَّهُ خَلَقَكُمْ ثُمَّ يَتَوَفَّاكُمْ. Allah is the one who created you, and he's the one who's going to bring you to an end. Okay, so the word يعني فتوفاه الله means أي قبض روحه. Allah took his soul, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah brought, وتوفاه الله means Allah تبارك وتعالى took his life. Point 26, inshallah wa ta'ala, على رأس 60 سنة. The author, rahimahullah, he now goes into ala ra'si sittina sana, which is the 26th point. And the rajih is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was 63 years of age. And we're going to speak about that, inshallah. There's a whole chapter where it's called fi babi sinni nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's the ending of the book, the age of the Prophet alayhi wa sallam. We're going to take it in the shama'il, inshallah ta'ala. Point 27, inshallah ta'ala, in the hadith that the Imam rahimahullah mentioned is, or the hadith of Anas ibn Malik mentioned, is that وَلَيْسَ فِي رَأْسِهِ وَلِحْيَتِهِ, it is not in his beard and his hair. يعني in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there was not in his beard and his hair. لِحْيَة is by, place kasra on the lamb, say لِحْيَة وَيَجُوزُ فَتْحُهَا, and you're allowed to say lahya. You can say lihya and lahya. You can say that. Both is correct. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his beard and his hair, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did not have in there 20 sha'ratan, it says. 20 gray hair was not in his beard, alayhi wa sallam. Salawatullahi wa sallam alayhi. He didn't have that, alayhi salatu wasalam. Ibn Sa'd narrated bi isnadin sahihin an thabitin an Anas. Yani thabit al-Bunani narrated from Anas ibn Malik. Specifically how much he had. Less than 20. Yeah, nah. We even know exactly how much he had. ما كان في رأس رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ولحيته أما ولحيته إلا 17 أو 18 شعرة بيضاء. The Prophet only had in his beard and his hair 17 or 18 white hair, grey hair. Ibn Abi Khaythama narrated min hadithi Humaydin an Anas, we're going to take inshallah ta'ala, lam yakun fi lihyati Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa ra'si 20 sha'ratan bayda kunna 17, Humayd mentions. And it was only 17 white hair he had, alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In his beard and his hair, the sahabas, they counted that. And there's a chapter where we're going to be speaking about the white beard in the Prophet's, the white hair that was in his beard and his hair. We're going to take that, inshallah ta'ala. We're going to take that. The word sha'ar, there are ways you can say it in the Arabic language. بسكون العين, you can say, place a sukun and say sha'ar. You can also place a fatha and say sha'ar. Sha'ar. Or you can say sha'ar. You can place bil fathi wa yusakkan. You can do both. You have a choice. Point 29 is with the author when he says 20 sha'rah. And sha'rah here is a sifa, is a description of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The 30th point, inshallah ta'ala, is where this hadith is narrated. This hadith is also narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari, and it's also narrated in Sahih Muslim. This whole entire hadith of Anas ibn Malik is narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari, and it is also narrated in Sahih Muslim. And al-Imam al-Tirmidhi himself narrated this in his Jami'ah. And in Jami'ah al-Tirmidhi, the hadith is also there. So it's not only in the Shama'il al-Muhammadiyya. It's in both of Bukhari's Sahih and Muslim's Sahih. And also the author himself, al-Imam al-Tirmidhi, rahimahullah, mentioned it in his Jami'ah. Those are the 30 points that I wanted us to take from this hadith, inshallah ta'ala. What we've taken, my beloved brothers and sisters, is that our Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was not excessively tall, nor was he excessively short. He was in the middle, alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We also took that the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was not excessively white, nor was he excessively black. He was in the middle, alayhi salatu wasalam. We also took that the Prophet's hair was not excessively curly, nor was his hair excessively straight. He was in the middle, alayhi salatu wasalam. We also took that the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, was sent as a prophet at the age of 40. And he stayed in Mecca for 13 years. Even though the narration mentioned 10, we say that the Arabs do that. The Arabs do that. They round it off to the nearest digit. And he stayed in Medina 10 years by unanimous agreement of the scholars. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala took his life, alayhi salatu wa salam, wa tawaffahu Allah ta'ala ala ra'si 60 sana. He died when he was 63 years of age. The Arabs do that, they round it off again. So it's 63, even though the narration mentions 60. وَلَيْسَ فِي رَأْسِهِ وَلَحْيَتِي أَمَا وَلِحْيَتِي. You can say it both ways. There was no يعني, hair in his beard and his head. 20 شَعْرَةً 20 بَيْضَاءَ 20 white, grey hair was not in the Prophet ﷺ's beard or head. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Alayhi salatu wa sallam. And we mentioned exactly how much he had, which was 17. Which shows you the Sahabas, how they observed him and they looked at him. And they transmitted all of that to us. I'm going to stop there, inshallah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are both free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdi, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. How can you do a 2-second action right now that will give you a share of the reward of everything we're doing on this YouTube channel? Simple. Like this video and click subscribe. Why? It will allow YouTube to recommend our videos to other users. And imagine the huge amount of reward that could be waiting for you on the Day of Judgment if you did that with a sincere intention of spreading the Deen of Allah. You'll be rewarded for every single person who benefits from one of our videos as a result of your like or subscribe. That's an easy 2-second action that you definitely don't want to miss out on. Do it now. Click like and subscribe, and don't forget to make that intention.